This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: Painted Veils. Author: James Huneker. Painted Veils. Toward the immutable land, Istar, daughter of Sin, bent her steps, toward the abode of the dead, toward the seven-gated abode where he entered, toward the abode whence there is no return. At the first gate, the warder stripped her. He took the high tiara from her head. At the second gate, the warder stripped her. He took the pendants from her ears. At the third gate, the warder stripped her. He took off the precious stones that adorn her neck. At the fourth gate, the warder stripped her. He took off the jewels that adorn her breast. At the fifth gate, the warder stripped her. He took off the girdle that encompasses her waist. At the sixth gate, the warder stripped her. He took the rings from her feet, the rings from her hands. At the seventh gate, the warder stripped her. He took off the last veil that covers her body. Istar, daughter of Sin, went into the immutable land. She took and received the waters of life. She gave the sublime waters, and thus, in the presence of all, delivered the Son of Life, her young lover. Epopee de Stubar, Sixth Chant, Englished by W. F. Abthorpe. VVV. The Seven Deadly Virtues. Now the seven deadly virtues are humility, charity, meekness, temperance, brotherly love, diligence, chastity. And the seven deadly arts are poetry, music, architecture, painting, sculpture, drama, dancing. This parable, with its notations and evocations of naked nerves and soul states, is inscribed in all gratitude to the charming morganatic ladies, les belles impures, who make pleasanter this vale of tears for virile men. What shall it profit a woman if she saves her soul, but loseth love? La pudeur. Belle vertu, qu'en attache sur soi avec des épingles. Madame de Pinay. L'amour cette forme meilleure de la charité. Catul Mendes. Lo the lesbians, their sterile sex advancing. Steeplejack. Down from the waist they are centaurs, though women all above, but to the girdle do the gods inherit, beneath is all the fiends, there's hell, there's darkness, there's the sulfurous pit, burning, scalding, stench, consumption, fie, fie, fie.
King Lear.
Act 4, Scene V. VVV. The First Gate. At the first gate, the warder stripped her. He took the high tiara from her head. 1. Until the day of her death, Easter never forgot that first night in New York. It was the initial twist of her ship's wheel, and the commonplace happenings which followed her entrance into the Maison Felice were to give force and direction to her entire life. The journey from Washington had been stupid. An early November afternoon sky heavy with threatening snow, her nerves tense with expectation, made the girl feel that the big city once reached her troubles would be over, but at Jersey City they began. After a few blunders, she reached the 23rd Street ferry and noted the snow falling in the foggy river. Her baggage had been checked to the hotel, and she had nothing to do but climb into a hansom and direct the driver to West 25th Street. She made a tentative bargain with the man. Easter was prudent because she had little money. The hotel, it was in reality two old-fashioned houses with high steps and brownstone façades, the conventional residence of the early 80s, did not impress her. Besides, it was snowing so thickly that she could hardly distinguish anything, and when she was admitted into the hall, the light dazzled her eyes. She felt lonely, timid, uncomfortable. A tall, portly lady saluted her. "You are Mie. Esther Brandis, I am Madame Felice." Her room had been engaged for a month ahead through the aid of a common friend. Her heart beat faster when the Frenchwoman politely said, "I am sorry, Mie. Brandis. Your room is occupied for a few days. We did not expect you till next week." The look of dismay on the newcomer's face must have appealed, for Madame added, "Booty shall put you in another room, a splendid apartment on the ground floor. You will like it. It will cost you only $5 a day, tout compris. Do you speak French?" Easter nodded. She was so appalled at the price that she was speechless. "But," she stammered.
"Yes, I know, continued Madam in her native tongue and more pleasantly, yes, I know, but it is only for 1 week and if Mie Brandis could see our waiting list. That settled the matter. She bowed her head, and soon a maid had her handbag open in a small bedroom adjoining a large, well-furnished room containing a grand pianoforte. There were three windows at the side. The piano, it is the property of Monsieur Invern. He is away till next week, said the two confidential gossip. Easter handed her a tip, and she bowed herself out. The chandelier gave plenty of light. There were bookcases. Much music. On the walls hung photographs of composers. Evidently, the apartment of a musical person. She looked out of a window. An extension with skylights, and a noise of clattering dishes, coupled with certain odors, not disagreeable to her nostrils, told her that the cuisine of the establishment was beneath. What she saw was the roof of the dining room. Maison Felice was one of those semi-hotels with table d'hôtes so popular in New York 2 or 3 decades ago. The cookery was French and notoriously good. Its fame spread to Virginia, where a friend of her mother's had secured after the funeral of the poor woman a letter of introduction to Madame Felice. It was not easy to get into the hotel as a permanent guest. Easter should have accounted herself lucky. She didn't. She was too miserably homesick for a home that no longer existed to bother about the exclusiveness of an hotel. Her glance traversed the lighted roof of the dining room, and through the fast-dropping snow it was arrested by a gloomy wall. Again her heart sank. My God, she cried. What a dismal prospect. Without parents and in her wallet $100, she was alone in New York. The situation was almost melodramatic. That snowstorm viewed in the aperture between two buildings and from the windows of a hired apartment made an ineradicable impression. For the first time in her life, she felt absolutely friendless. Madame had told her the hour for dinner, 7 till 8 p.m., the luncheon was till 2 o'clock, and breakfast eaten in the room. A foreign atmosphere permeated the house. She turned away from the depressing night, lighted all the gas burners, pulled down the shades and proceeded to make a modest toilette. Her trunk hadn't arrived, so she must eat her first meal in street clothes. No gong had sounded. Summoning courage, she pressed a button. No answer, but from the sounds of talking and general bustle, she knew that dinner was served. Another embarrassment. How to enter a dining room full of strangers? Easter was a well-bred young woman, but not accustomed to the world. Above all, to a bohemian world. At the Maison Felice, she had been informed that the guests were celebrated. Singers, painters, actors, musicians there congregated. A perfect bohemia where she would rub elbows, even speak to the people she most admired, artistic folk. She crossed a parlor and found herself on a landing from which she could see a long table in the middle of the room, with little tables ranged along the walls. A numerous company was assembled, gabbling, eating, drinking, seemingly happy. An old chap with a bald head and grizzled mustaches saluted her rather markedly. His eyes were bloodshot. He looked prosperous and authoritative. I wish you the good evening and a welcome, mademoiselle, he said. You must be tired and hungry, I am Monsieur Felice. Come with me, I give you a table to yourself with only one other guest. But a nice young man, I assure you, quite an old friend of the house. His speech was voluble, accompanied by many gestures. He was Provençal, his wife Swiss. He stared at the girl. She was pretty, though not to his taste. He preferred blondes. She sat herself at a table near the short flight of steps that led from the foyer to the salle à manger. She was alone. Soon her soup was served. It was like wine to her faded spirits. Easter felt more cheerful. Decidedly, a full stomach is an obstacle to melancholy. She sipped a glass of red wine. Her humor began to mellow. The soup was excellent, the fish promising, and then there stood before her, slightly bowing, a small, slender young man who introduced himself. Papa Felice tells me I'm to have the honor of sitting at dinner with you.
My name is Stone, Alfred Stone, at your service. His manner was a trifle formal. He looked about 40 and was barely 30. A young old man, worn, though not precisely dissipated-looking. Easter didn't know whether she liked or disliked him. She resented his presence because he disturbed her dreams. But when he asked her name, she became interested. Papa Felice says you are a singer, Miss Brandis. Brandis. That must be a Jewish name. No, I am not Jewish. And my first name, Esther. My father was born in Virginia. So was I. He may have had Jewish blood in his veins, I don't know. He said his father was a Dane. Aha, cried Stone. Georg Brandis, the Danish writer, is a Jew, and there is Marta Brandis of Paris, you know, the beautiful actress. I've never been to Paris, interrupted Easter. Is she a great actress, this Marta Brandis? Not so great as alluring. Yes, she is great if compared with any English or American actress. His dark eyes glowed. He almost became animated. Easter listened with curiosity. A man who spoke with such surety was somebody. Who was this Mr. Stone? She tried him with a touch of flattery. You must have seen a lot of actresses to pass such a judgment. He became quite languid.
Miss Brandis, I am a critic of the theater and music.
She eagerly responded. A critic of music. How nice. His depression increased. What's nice about it? He asked in a sullen tone. Oh, to hear all the great singers and players.
You mean, to be forced to hear a lot of mediocrities.
Even the great ones, Lily Lehman Brandt, the Dariskis, get on my nerves. You can have too much of a good thing, my dear young lady. She became still more absorbed. Now tell me. What are you after? He demanded in kindly fashion. I mean to be a great dramatic soprano, she confidently asserted. Aha, he vouchsafed. Rather a modest program. I mean to accomplish it, she retorted. He was visibly impressed. Of course, a great voice you must have to begin with, and then there are such items as vocal technique and dramatic temperament and beauty. You are well supplied in that, he gallantly bowed. Thank you, said the girl, not in the least abashed. She knew she was good-looking. And how many other qualifications? He interposed. I speak French. My mother was a Frenchwoman. I speak Italian, without an accent, my teacher said. Without an Italian accent, he meant. No, with a Tuscan accent, the girl proudly replied. And I'm a trained musician, a solo pianist and accompanist, and read and transpose at sight. He wearily waved her words away. Yes, yes, I know all about you girls who play, sing, transpose, and compose. There's Yankee versatility, if you please. Universal genius. And you couldn't compose a role, any more than you could cook your husband's dinner, if you were unlucky enough to have one. Easter smiled and it was like sunrise. Something inexpressibly youthful came into the world. At any rate, I have a good dinner if I haven't the husband, she challenged. He assented. The cuisine here is famous. Not at Martin's or Delmonico's, or down on 14th Street at Moretti's is there better flavored food. They had not reached coffee. The sweets were insignificant. Easter positively became buoyant. She must have had Celtic in her. She went from the cellar to the clouds and the clouds to the cellar with such facility. Her awareness once achieved, the rebound was sure to follow. Momentarily she forgot her poverty, loneliness, strangeness, and Mr. Stone was like a friend in need. She played confidential. All my life I've been at music. I was born near Warrington on a farm. Then we moved to Richmond. Papa was unfortunate. I appeared as a child prodigy. Later I taught little girls, some older than myself. I began singing in the cradle, Mother said. Poor dear mother. She was so wrapped up in my musical career. He thought, they all say the same things, already career. She died last spring. Father has been away for years, Easter hesitated, and here I am with lots of conceit and no money to speak of, and yet he mean to succeed. He admired her, this tall black-haired girl with the broad shoulders and steady eyes. Physical signs augured well. Her ears were small, shapely, her throat a tower of strength. Her bust was undeveloped, but the chest measurement unusual. He couldn't see her hips, but she sat boldly upright, and there was decision in every movement, every attitude. Her eyes did not please his fastidious demands. They were not full-orbed, rather small, deep-set, and he couldn't make up his mind whether in color they were dark blue or dark green. At times they seemed both, but they went well with the blue-black hair coiled about a wide low forehead. The nose was too large for canonic beauty, but it was boldly jutting, not altogether aquiline, a good rudder for a striking countenance, and one that might steer her little ship through stormy weather. The ensemble promised. But Stone had witnessed so many auspicious beginnings that the brilliant girl, whose speech was streaked with an agreeable southern accent, did not altogether convince him. "Another," he commented, but inaudibly. He gravely inquired if she had any letters to musical people.
"Yes, to Madame Frisch Maddie for one.
Also, a letter from our U.S. Senator to the director of the Metropolitan Opera House." She beamed. Stone looked at her. "Madame Frisch Maddie is a great dramatic soprano, but she hasn't much time for pupils, she is so busy with concert work. But you may have a chance, if your voice is as good as you believe it to be. La Frisch has a class 2 afternoons in the week at the Conservatoire Cosmopolitain, and aussi no Madame Meyerbeer, the director, I could give you a letter to her. Better still, I could take you to her and introduce you, that is, if you care to go." "He is interested, without doubt," thought Easter. She was in a gleeful mood but held herself down. The effervescent kitten tricks might not please this cynical critic. She gladly accepted his offer. They slowly moved from the half-deserted room. 2 hours had quickly passed. She was surprised. Stone spoke. "It's too soon after eating, yet he wish I could hear your voice. Then he might judge. Perhaps Frisch Maddie won't bother with an amateur. Her forte is not tone production but style. She is an operatic stylist. To hear her deliver Pleures, Mise You from the Cid, or Printemps from Samson et Delilah is something to remember. The true Gallic tradition, broad and dramatic, with justesse in expression. Ah!
Only Lily is her superior."
Out of breath, he paused. He was seldom so expansive, he loathed enthusiasm. His motto in life was Horatian. To this he superadded Richelieu's injunction, point to zeal. And now he was spilling over like a green provincial. "Evil communications," he sighed. Easter clapped her hands. As she felt herself to be the pivot of the universe, visible and invisible, she spoke only of her own sensations. "Teachers say that my voice is placed to perfection. I don't think there will be much trouble about Madame Frisch. However, Mr. Stone, if it is allowed in this hotel, I occupy a parlor, and there is a pianoforte." It was soon settled. Madame Felice was gracious. So was Monsieur. They were both poker players, and were only too glad to get to the table in their private apartment. "Hello," exclaimed Stone, "you have Invern's place, haven't you?" They were in the girl's apartment. "Who is Invern?" she mildly inquired. "Ulick Invern, a writer, incidentally a critic. He has lived here ever since he came from Paris." "No, he isn't a Frenchman. Paris-born, of New York stock, but a confirmed Parisian." "So am I, poor devil, that I am. But he is rich, at least well-to-do, and he must make my salt writing for the newspapers." "Go ahead. Sing some scales mezzo voce, at first, it won't be such an effort at that." Easter sang. 2 octaves she glided through. "Phew," cried her listener. "Big, fruity, lots of color, velvety. But who placed your voice, did you say?" The girl stubbornly answered, "Mrs. Dodd," and she said, "Rot." No matter what she said. "You have a rare voice. It's a pity it wasn't taken in hand sooner. But you sing by the grace of God. Naturally. And that's something. No, Frisch won't bother with you. Madame Ash is your woman. She will get that refractory break in your register, safely back on the rails. Take my word for it, miss, he hesitated. Esther Brandis, my friends nickname me Easter, any answer to that, she confessed. Well, Miss Easter, I'm not so sure that your self-confidence, egotism is sometimes a form of genius, you know, isn't justified. You have voice, presence, intelligence, ambition. Good Lord, a lot of singers with half your gifts have become famous. It all depends on you and chance. Don't mock that word, chance. Luck is two-thirds the battle. I'd rather be lucky than rich. He ruefully thought of the last horse race at which the bookmakers had picked his ribs bare. What time shall he call for you tomorrow? 9 o'clock, she quickly responded, all flame. Good heavens, girl. That's the middle of the night. Let us say, after luncheon. I'll be here at 3 o'clock. I can't get in for luncheon, Aussie don't rise till midday. Then, ho, for the Conservatoire Cosmopolitan, where they teach you to sing in every language but your own. Madame Meyerbeer is Gallic or nothing. He made a formal bow and took his leave. Easter stood at the pianoforte, dreaming. Was it, after all, coming, the realization of her mother's solitary ambition? But once between the sheets, Easter didn't dream. The day and its wonderful events had exhausted her. She was awakened in broad daylight by the maid who asked her if she would have coffee or chocolate. 2. Alfred Stone reflected, she is unusual. Never mind her beauty or her voice, it's her personality that will win out. What curious eyes. Hard as steel when she doesn't like the way things are going. Big heart. Yes, for herself. A cold hard-boiled egg is that same heart. Temperament. Well, I don't know. She may be as hot as a red-hot stove, but she is cerebral all the same. Never will waste herself in the swamp of sensual sentimentality. She will learn to use a man just as a man uses a woman. Un, deux, trois, c'est fini. That's the only way. Like trying on a new pair of gloves. Do they fit? No. Chuck 'em away, I think Frida Ash is the right card for her, not Fersh. Easter is not ready yet for the footlights. He walked into the vestibule of the Maison Felice, and to his surprise, found her waiting for him. What? Punctuality in a future prima donna, he jested. Easter disliked him this afternoon. She was in an umbrageous humor. She had slept soundly, the day was clear, the air crisp, the snow was not ankle-deep. Why had she turned cold? She didn't know. Stone suddenly bored her. Yet she had passed the morning thinking of him. Why his sudden interest? Would he try to profit by her? Such things she had read about in musical journals. Managers who didn't advertise were denounced by unselfish editors. Perhaps he would make a commission by taking her to the Cosmopolitan. Nasty, mean suspicions closed in upon her. She couldn't shake them off. She sang some scales, she read without interest a morning newspaper that she had found in the rusty drawing room. The French breakfast of chocolate and rolls didn't appeal to her. She possessed a young, healthy appetite, and she missed the cozy chatter of the American breakfast table. Several times she peeped through the glass door of her apartment, but saw no one. Various noises told her that the household was cleaning. In despair, she took a warm bath and admired the rickety old tub, sheet iron, not porcelain. She admired her body's lithe length as she faced an oval mirror. I am nice, she thought. Smooth, white, not hairy like so many girls I know. Her breasts were sketchy, but her bosom was so massive that a rich harvest was certain. Her pelvic curve was classic, her legs long and not knock-kneed. The Lord be praised for that much, she said aloud. It was her hair that most pleased her. Black with a suggestion of blue, it was like a helmet on her small head. Its tone was faintly echoed in the armpits and on the tache d'encre, as they say in the painter's atelier. A robust girl and a desirable one, though the languorous, voluptuous air was absent. Easter might be profoundly immoral, but never a slimy odalisque. Her temperament was too tonic. Passion, yes, to the edge of tatters. Foaming passion, but no man would ever call her slave. This she resolved as she squeezed her tiny breasts. Then she bowed low to her image, kicked her right leg on high, turned her comely back, peeped over her shoulder, mockingly stuck out her tongue as she regarded with awe, almost, the width of her delicately modeled buttocks. "Good heavens," she exclaimed. "I hope I'm not going to get a married woman's bottom, like Amy Brown's." Then she slowly dressed, after much pagan joy over her physical beauty. She ate everything they brought her, at the luncheon table.
"Starved, that's what I am.
Nothing since last night." She was glad to be alone at table. She wished to think over the situation. Her money wouldn't last long. What then? Not for a moment did she consider the possibility of a complacent rich man. She knew her value in that direction, always or nearly always, having a man messing about you. No, she preferred her liberty, the most precious liberty of sleeping solo, of arising in the morning alone. She swallowed her demi-tasse and found Stone at the door. "Let's walk to Union Square," he said, and she assented. They went across to Broadway. He quietly studied his companion, who, in the liveliest spirits, hummed, chattered, flirted with every good-looking man she passed, and elbowed her companion into a state of irritation. He was a stickler for the nuances of behavior, especially in women. He, the bohemian, frequenter of racecourses, gambling hells, cafes, cocottes, and even worse, couldn't tolerate a slang phrase from the mouth of a woman. He saw that Easter was crude, though not coarse. Her education had been the normal, unintelligent education of small towns. She hadn't been taught to talk, walk, or dress properly. Nevertheless, she wasn't slouchy, and her bearing distinctive. She was Esther Brandis, and 6 months hence she would be a full-fledged New York woman. Of that he was assured. Perhaps sooner. And men? She liked them, he saw that. Had she? Who could tell? She wasn't shy. She hadn't thus far blushed. To be sure, the conversation hadn't strayed from the conventional. Then he laughed. She turned to him. "Let me laugh too," she begged. "I was thinking," he explained, "of an old maid aunt of mine who used to pray the Lord she wouldn't die guessing." Easter stopped and unrestrainedly roared. He was scandalized. "Hurry up," he expostulated. "We shall be late, otherwise." But he was secretly elated at the quick-fire success of his joke. "A smart girl that, she will go far, perhaps too far." They went into the Conservatoire Cosmopolitan. The door was opened by a polite colored man. He said Madam was busy just then. Wouldn't they wait in the reception room? Stone called the old man George and gave him a cigarette. The room was on the first floor facing the entrance hall. At the stroke of 4, gabble was heard. Girls and young men with fiddle cases and music rolls tumbled downstairs, while fresh classes were forming. A weary or bored instructor bustled among his pupils. A gong struck. "Now ladies, now gentlemen," called out George. "Upstairs please for Monsieur Lapoule's class." "It's run like a railway station here," said Stone. Then added in French, "We shall see Madame Meyerbeer first, but don't say anything about Fersh Maddie. I'd like to get you on the free list, then, perhaps, you might help out by accompanying." Easter tried to look grateful, but couldn't. "What do they pay accompanists by the hour?" she naively inquired. "Pon my word," he answered, "you are a regular pawnbroker."
"Oh, it's all very well for you."
"You're a man, I must work for my living." She was tart. He grimly smiled. "A critic who has to listen to rotten singers isn't working, is he? Hello, here's Madame." A pretty plump little woman, picturesquely garbed in brown-ribbed velvet, wearing a man's collar and cravat artistically tied, tripped into the room and in French bade them the time of day. Stone took her apart and whispered in her little ear, which her loosely piled iron-gray hair did not conceal. But she was all eyes for the girl, who in turn devoured this model Parisienne. "And she is an American, what chic," thought Easter. "A voice, you say, Alfred, and such good looks, I should say so. Come upstairs, Miss Brandis. Nice stage name, eh, Alfred? Of course, she will go into the first class." "I don't know about that," answered Stone, who seemed to be an oracle in the eyes of Madam. I should rather say Ash. The young lady has a lot to learn, a long road to travel, yes, but me no buts, he retorted. With Fersh Maddie, she will only get a vocal top dressing, whereas it's the roots that need attending to.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.